Oh yeah, it's the Freedom Feens Live. It is Saturday, July 20th and such. I'm Neema Vedadi, broadcasting from Austin, Texas. And we've also got Michael W. Dean. He'll let you know where he's repping.
Broadcasting live and worldwide from a windowless bunker at an undisclosed location in the rural wild mountain west in the occupied states of America.
Of course. Sounds good. Good and times.
We have someone else today. We have a very special guest broadcasting from a compound of underground distilleries in Appalachia. We have our friend Larken Rose. How you doing there, Larken Rose?
Pretty good. Watching for drones, but so far so good.
Yeah. You know, there's a town in Colorado where the town fathers or elders or board or the city council has gotten together and proposed legislation to have the city offer a $25 bounty on any drones that are shot down. Did you hear about that?
Oh, I saw that. I did see it. About that. I'm going to move there.
That's, you have to bring like a wing of the drone or a piece of the propeller prove it.
Yeah, you need some evidence, of course.
That's a pretty low bounty. I mean, in Louisiana, they used to give you like $2 to shoot a nutria rat. Those are probably a lot easier to shoot than a drone.
That's what I was thinking. $25. I mean, what is this, Monopoly? Like, they need to adjust for inflation on that one.
Well, how many drones do they have? Maybe their skies are just full of them.
Maybe.
It's like
maybe
a flock of quail that fly up when you walk into a bush.
Skeet shoot them.
Shoot them with some birdshot. Yeah.
Well, maybe the bounty's so low.
Definitely depth shot.
Maybe they're small government Republicans who want to not steal quite as much to shoot down the drones. You know, in San Francisco, if they had a drone shoot down program, the bounty would probably be $10,000, but they would not have one.
There's some real interesting conditions too.
Sniping.
Right. other kinds of responsibilities too. There's a restriction that you're limited to 3 shots at an aircraft every 2 hours because anything less demonstrates a lack of proficiency with the weapon.
I don't know if I want to live somewhere that people are randomly firing rifles into the air. I mean, you know,
well, if they're smart, they'll use shotguns and then it doesn't matter too much. It's not going that bad.
You know, to some people that sounds like a libertarian paradise, but you know what I say? If you want a libertarian paradise, move to Detroit. And we're going to talk about Detroit a little bit. I guess we didn't really introduce Larken Rose. Larken Rose is a Liberty superstar. His name is spelled Larken Rose, if you want to go look him up. And his website is Larkenrose.com. And there you can go and see his feisty and hilarious and right on videos and see his books, including The Most Dangerous Superstition, and read about his interesting history, which does include spending a year in federal prison for, I don't know if it was tax evasion or tax avoidance or just, I think it was tax. I don't like taxes. I think that was the...
I didn't even get something as glorious as tax evasion, which is a felony. I got misdemeanor willful failure to file. In other words, I didn't send pieces of paper to the IRS, so they caged me for a year.
What did you do in brief? And, you didn't think you were not going to maybe go to prison. You weren't one of these people who thinks if I use magic words, I'm immune and they can't see me. You actually were challenging something and willing to go to prison, right?
Well, I mean, I was hoping to win. It wasn't a matter of, like, if people said, oh, you thought you'd get a fair day in court. No, I expect the judge to serve the people who appointed him and work for him, which is the control freaks. And I expect the prosecution to lie, cheat, and steal all they can. And they did. The reason I actually wanted it in the context of a criminal prosecution is because then 12 supposedly random chosen jury members make the final decision. And I thought, all I need is 1 out of 12 Americans to not be a complete moron, but didn't get it.
That's a losing bet. Sorry, Larken.
That's weird. You know, when people say America is the greatest country in the world and we still have liberty, and try going to court, man, if you think we still have liberty and things are great.
Right. But I did. I mean, from the beginning, I said, whether I win or lose, I want people to watch this. And I told people, don't do this. I'm not saying here's what you do and nothing bad will happen. I'm saying I'm putting myself in trouble on purpose because whether I win or lose, there will be a lot to learn about what your quote unquote government is really like. And there was. And it would have been more fun to demonstrate that without sitting in a cage for a year. But oh well. A lot of people told me that watching that fiasco, and I won't bother to get into the legal issue and all that. People can look that up. But a lot of people learned the hard way that the show they put on CNN and court TV, that isn't the reality. If you annoy the powers that be, all rules are out the window.
What is the reality of being a political prisoner? I mean, that's what you were. What was going through your head for that year?
Well, I would like to be able to pretend that I'm a Zen master and was at peace. And I was pretty darn annoyed with mostly with the 12 buffoons in the jury box, because the reason I was there was to tell them that they were being lied to and robbed. And so, again, the case wasn't anything about me. I didn't hide anything. I didn't lie about anything. And the government admitted that I was very open. I told them I was stopping filing, and I told them why, and I asked to meet with them. And again, it's a giant story that people can go look up if they want. But while inside, it was a little annoying thinking. I basically put myself in a position where I was telling 12 people that your own government is defrauding you of a huge amount of money. And they decided, I think you should be caged for telling us that.
Yeah, and
it's a little annoying.
La la la, I don't want to hear it. La 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 la.
And if people go to look it up, I would recommend starting at larkenrose.com, LarkenRose.com, because if you just search randomly on Google for Larken Rose tax prison or whatever, you're going to end up on some sites that are apologists for the government that not only say he was horrible, but also say, also lump him in with people who have very little to do with him, who are people who publish books on how to avoid paying taxes, who are, some of them are in prison now, still selling books on how to avoid paying taxes. Larken is not one of those people. He's not telling you how to pay taxes. He did a civil disobedience and ended up in jail, in prison.
And if you want the whole ridiculous story and have a whole $5 to spare, the ebook of Kicking the Dragon, which is my book, it goes through the whole thing, the trial, the meetings, and it quotes what actually happened, as opposed to the extortion apologists out there who love to throw out any insults and condemnations against anybody who doesn't bow to the master and kiss the ring. So it was a giant ridiculous story. I'm just glad a lot of people learned a lot from it, it would have been more fun to win and have them learn stuff from it, but oh well.
Yeah.
Well, do you think there's something to learn from Adam Kokesh's recent run-in? He was, his home was raided by a SWAT team. Apparently, the tip-off for the SWAT team was this video he made of his, quote, armed march on D.C., which really wasn't that. It was more of a loading a shotgun while standing up in front of the camera. I don't think he should have been jailed for it, but what do you think of that? Do you have any initial impressions? Is that going to teach people things?
Well, it will teach different people different things depending on what assumptions they had going in. I mean, Adam, I've met Adam and talked to him a few times, and he obviously knows what he's doing. I'm sure he wasn't all that shocked that they went after him for doing that. And initially it was going to be a march on Washington, and that was like postponed for a year. And then by himself, he went and did this video and somewhere between the Capitol and the White House or something. I'm not sure exactly where. So it was an act of civil disobedience. So
he did it is a place called Freedom Plaza.
Liberty Plaza. It's literally halfway. It's equidistant. And that was specifically chosen, I believe. Exactly.
What are you doing acting like a free person in Liberty Plaza?
Yeah.
So that's pretty funny. I always sort of back up and look at the overall thing of what will this look like to people? Not what actually happened and what was the intended message, but how will this be distorted and twisted and how will it be perceived? It was totally an act of civil disobedience. It wasn't anything violent. He wasn't like threatening people and running around shooting people. He did a little video and disobeyed their so-called gun laws, which oddly enough, the Supreme Court even threw out already. So it'll be interesting to see what happens with that. I think there's a divide, and I don't much care that there's a divide. I think, you know, that's how it is. In this country, lots of people will say, oh, you broke the law, so they should throw you in a cage for 10 years or whatever. And lots of other people will say, yeah, that this law is stupid and this government is turning tyrannical. And yeah, go disobey. Ha ha. So I think mostly what people will get out of it depends on what they already believed coming in. But I'm thrilled that it has gotten attention and that, you know, Fox News actually didn't completely condemn him and spin it and had this little few minute segment with him talking about it in prison and actually represented what he thinks.
Let's play that segment, Neema, and then we'll discuss it when we come back from the break. We have just enough time to play before the break.
And a caveat, this is a local Fox affiliate. It's My Fox DC, so it's not National Fox. But
I think it got replayed a bit on National Fox and other in snippets out of context on other networks.
Well, the local fellas did the work, and here's the work that they did.
Yeah.
A Fox 5 exclusive tonight. Anti-government activist Adam Kokesh denies any connection to the drugs that federal officers say they found in his home. But he admits the shotgun he loaded on Freedom Plaza in D.C. on the 4th of July was the real deal. John Hanrahan conducted the jailhouse interview and joins us from the newsroom now with our Fox 5 exclusive. John?
Well, stop the presses. This may be the biggest headline of all. Pro-gun activist Adam Kokesh says someday he's going to run as an independent for the presidency, and his platform is going to be a simple one. Abolish the federal government. Adam?
How you doing, sir?
Since July 9th, 31-year-old Adam Kokesh has been incarcerated in a cell in the Fairfax County Jail, which measures 7 by 7.5 feet. On Independence Day, Kokesh had a colleague shoot a video of the pro-gun activist loading a shotgun on D.C.'s Freedom Plaza. U.S. Park Police used a flash grenade when their SWAT team later served a search warrant at Kokesh's home in Herndon. Kokesh was arrested when officers say they found hallucinogenic mushrooms at the house. In an exclusive jailhouse interview, Adam Kokesh denies any connection to the drug.
If they found a stash of magic mushrooms in my house, they would not
mind. This is the Freedom Fiends.
We'll have more.
After going to the market.
Five centuries after the first spaceflight, the stars remain beyond humanity's reach. So a mad scientist enlists the aid of a young technician, Nicole Orem, as they travel through the solar system, encountering the hazards of space and human treachery. Quantum Vibe, Volume 1, Nicole, collects the first 400 strips of the epic sci-fi webcomic series, available now from the major online bookstores or direct from bigheadpress.com.
You've read books, attended lectures, and you know the Constitution well enough to know it's a well-crafted blueprint to create an ever-increasing federal empire. But there's still one thing missing.
Buttons!
Freedom Feens now has buttons. You'll get state speech is hate speech, guns and weed, buy sheep for sheep on sheep, and two designs for the Freedom Feens. Wear them with pride. Use them to start conversations with statists. It's only $10 for 5 buttons, including shipping. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the link at the top that says Buttons.
A science fiction comic adventure from Big Head Press. Quantum Vibe. It's year 2523. There are colonies on Venus, Mars, and Mercury. People travel in bubbles, fly at hyperspeed, with brain implants and artificial gravity. A scientific genius and his clever assistant set out on an adventure through the solar system on a secret mission to find the key to access new frontiers and save liberty. Quantum Vibe. There's a robot girl and zany creatures made with genetically engineered features, and corporate villains crave the opportunity to steal a profit from mother's ingenuity. A scientific genius and his clever assistant set out on an adventure through the solar system on a secret mission to find the key to access new frontiers and save liberty. QuantumVibe.com.
Yeah, that's That's that kind of punk music they played up in D.C. back in the day.
Yeah.
This is Neema Vedadi. I am a Freedom Fiend. We've also got our fellow fiend, Michael W. Dean.
Yeah, and I'm the guy who wrote the song we just listened to, which is from my band Right Arm of Wyoming. And the song is called Would You Tar and Feather a Tax Collector? Ooh. And no segue to Larken Rose. How you doing there, Larken Rose?
Pretty good.
Yeah.
Still here.
Yeah. So, Larken wrote an interesting video. We're going to talk about that video later about his, the true meaning of the Second Amendment, which is not the title of it. The title can't be said on radio, and there's no swearing on the title of the video. So let's play the rest of this Adam Kokesh video that we had to take a break for commerce to, which is cool because we love commerce. So go ahead, Neema. Go ahead with your bad self.
In an exclusive jailhouse interview, Adam Kokesh denies any connection to the drugs.
If they found a stash of magic mushrooms in my house, they were not mine.
Any idea whose they were or why they were in your house?
I'm pretty confident that whether or not they found anything, the full paper bags that they brought into my house would ensure that they would have charges to bring against me.
Are you implying that those drugs were planted?
Yes.
Kokesh, who's been arrested several times by U.S. Park Police, says that agency has a vendetta against him. He believes the evidence in the drug case is weak. Federal officers have now filed a weapons charge against Kokesh for wielding the shotgun on the 4th of July.
Was it a real shotgun, and were they really shells going into it in the video you posted?
Yes.
You did know that that was illegal in D.C.
It's called civil disobedience.
Adam Kokesh believes the Second Amendment to the Constitution will provide him a successful defense against the D.C. gun charge. The former U.S. Marine who served in Iraq plans to bring his anti-government views before voters.
Are you running for president?
Yes, sir, in 2020 on the platform of an orderly dissolution of the United States federal government.
Why is that a good idea?
Why is having the federal government a good idea at this point?
Adam Kokesh believes the U.S. military is more harmful than helpful to American security, and the government as a whole has burdened its citizenry with debt. Adam Kokesh is 70% disabled from his military service. He says he lives on that money. His supporters, through their anti-government website, are asking people to send money for bail and send money to hire a lawyer. But for now, the future presidential candidate, Adam Kokesh, is residing in the Fairfax County Jail. Will?
Yeah.
Huh. Interesting tag there. I had no idea that Kokesh was getting disability money from the military. Did you?
Yeah, and people criticize him for that, and I think that's stupid. I mean, that's like people criticizing Mike V for getting Social Security when he paid into it his whole life, and I'm not even going to go there. But that was interesting news. I liked it. It was well-produced news, especially in that was a TV piece, and it totally worked on radio. It was kind of like an NPR-type production of it, you know, the way it told the whole story with radio, which makes me wonder why TV is even necessary anymore. It's not. Should just go to radio. Larken?
Yeah.
Yes.
The thing that, you know, I always watch these things, you know, from the vantage point of a propagandist, like, well, what are they trying to persuade people of that they're not saying? And I was actually pretty amazed by how accurately they portrayed what Adam believes in, what he's saying and what he's doing. Because usually, you know, they take their opponents and twist it into something different and take things out of context, and which, you know, I'm sure plenty of other people are doing. The one thing I did notice is they kept using the term anti-government. And I think it's sort of funny because that's even a lot of people who say they believe in freedom are scared to death of that label. Let me be on the record saying I am absolutely 100% anti-government in every way, shape, and form. And people, like, I think it's slowly wearing away. Like, it used to be that people would say, we need less this and more freedom and that. Are you anti-government? No, I'm not at all anti-government. I'm just for a government that don't know. Well, I'm looking
out the window for the drones right now with you saying this, but go on.
And the thing is, I think the important thing is to have people understand why good people have to be anti-government. And why good people should be enemies of the state, which is another way I describe myself. I'm totally an enemy of the state because the state is always the enemy of morality and justice. It's not that I just decided to pick a fight or want to go attack somebody. I don't want to attack anybody. I want people to not attack me. And the state, by its nature, always attacks innocent people.
That's kind of the weird conundrum of saying one is anti-government, because people instantly assume it means you want to take up arms and hurt people and destroy things, and it doesn't. You know, I mean, I don't like polka music, but I'm not going out to destroy it. I just want to. I want polka music to leave me alone.
Right, exactly.
Although there's a difference, because I think polka has a right to exist, and I don't think
and it doesn't generally attack people.
No, not at all.
Well, we'll be back.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Neema V and Michael Dean. They'll be right back just as soon as this drone is out of range. Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies! Jesus. On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, The Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Neema Vedadi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
Yeah, it's the Freedom Feens. We're back. I'm Neema Vedadi. We've got Michael W. Dean. We've also got Larken Rose in the house, lead singer for Roses with Guns. How you doing, Larken?
Pretty good.
Yeah, and we're going to do some clarifying here, and it's not backpedaling, and it's not apologist. I just want to be really clear about some things. I'm more worried about losing stations than I am about getting my door kicked in. I accept that it's an inevitability that we'll get our door kicked in at some point. So I do want to point out Larken Rose is a family man. He and his family, he's a good man, and he's a good husband and father and a peaceful man, and he even plays music with his family. They are like the libertarian Partridge family, sort of, the anarcho-capitalist Partridge family. But I want to be really clear about the anti-government statement. I mean, people hear that and they think it means you want to blow stuff up and kill people. It does not. I mean, I think a weird analogy would be being anti-abortion doesn't mean you want to kill people who do abortions. For most people, I mean, there are exceptions, and there are people who've been anti-government in the distant past or in the past who've done violent things. But you are you a violent person, Larken?
No. In fact, the reason that I'm anti-government is that I oppose the initiation of violence. And every government in the history of the world has initiated violence against innocent people. And it's, you know, in theory, somebody could be opposed to government because they want to run around hurting people and they don't want cops to stop them. But of the thousands of anarchists I know, none of them are anarchists because of that reason. All of them are anarchists precisely because they recognize that government is inherently violent. It doesn't, you know, the laws and taxes it makes up are all threats. You have to do this, you're not allowed to do this, and give us your money or we hurt you. And so the reason, it's sort of funny that so many people have been trained to be scared of anarchists, even though they're literally the only group of people in the world who oppose initiating violence against you. Every person in the world, everyone listening out there, everyone not listening out there, I don't want anyone in the world to take one penny from you without your consent, whether they call it taxes or anything else. I don't want them to ever initiate violence against you. You can do anything you want except attack somebody else, in which case they have the right to defend themselves. But being an anarchist doesn't mean I want to go blow up buildings or overthrow the government. I want people to understand that what humanity should be is a group of people voluntarily acting, a group of equals, no masters, no slaves, and nobody pretending to have the right to rule. And so it's so strange to me that the only group that is truly tolerant of other people, the only group that says, leave everybody alone. If they're not attacking you, don't attack them by government or anything else. They're characterized as this scary, violent bunch of people, and they are literally the only people in the world who believe in real peace and justice and morality.
Now, a lot of statists will come back at that with something like, well, if you didn't have a government, then you would just have the richest, most powerful people. They would just start controlling you anyway, and then you would still have yourself being aggressed against, and the corporations would run the world, and it'd be the same thing. I mean, I don't buy that, but let's hear your debunking of it.
Yeah, well, first of all, it's sort of funny because really what their argument is if we did away with government, we would end up with government. Like, really? That's the worst case scenario. But the people who argue that hugely underestimate the factor that people's perception plays. And I use the example, if China decided to invade and inflict on us exactly what the U.S. Congress does now, they would never get away with it. If they said, you have to give us 20, 30, 40% of everything you earn, if they weren't perceived as a rightful ruling class, they would have no prayer of forcibly subjugating 300 million Americans, 100 million of whom have guns. The only group that can carry off that level of oppression and extortion and forcible control is the group imagined to have the right to do it. So the idea that if we didn't all imagine a legitimate ruling class, somebody would rule us by brute force, is completely unrealistic. It's like saying if you didn't imagine that somebody had the right to swipe money from your bank account, then somebody would come along and point a gun at you and rob you. Well, if I at least understood that he didn't have the right to rob me, I would be a step ahead because I might be able to defend myself. So people miss how important the belief in, because that's really what I'm against, is people imagining that when you call something legislation and government and law, then it's okay to use that to initiate violence against other people. That's what has to go. That's superstition.
Neema, do you have, can you cue up that MSNBC short clip of,
We've been following
this whole Detroit thing where Detroit is the most visible example of how more government causes more problems. And it's interesting because everyone I know who's anything in the spectrum between like small government, Tea Party, you know, minarchist to anarchist, all of them, constitutionalist to anarchist, basically, all of the people who want less to no government are all trumpeting, including me, trumpeting Detroit as an example of you know, Lou from the Feens is calling it the failed state project. And we actually made a meme arguing against the broken windows fallacy, which is the Keynesian idea that broken windows cause jobs. And we have a picture of a window of a building in Detroit with almost all the windows broken out of it. And Lou's saying, which is, if broken windows cause prosperity, Detroit would be paved with gold. And Detroit just filed for bankruptcy. And everyone I know who's a small government to no government person is saying, see, we told you. But part of the way that the lie of more government is necessary is reinforced, which causes the thing Larken's talking about of people accepting tyranny in all forms, little and big, is the mainstream media. And here's an MSNBC clip of a couple apologists, starting with Howard Dean, no relation to me.
No relation.
No relation to me. And then some lady who's a political analyst, of all things, on MSNBC, explaining why the complete opposite is true. She's saying the lie is true. And I say, if you want no government, move to Detroit. That's basically what she's saying. You know, people say that about Somalia, but she's substituting Detroit and telling a big lie to millions of people. So go ahead and play that, Neema.
Yep.
Detroit's going to come back. It is going to come back. When you have a medium home price of $45,000, people are going to go buy those houses sooner or later, but you've got to have a government to run the place.
Yeah. And Melissa,
that point about having a government is, I think, part of, I mean, we can talk about the micro story of Detroit, but it seems to me that Detroit, as always, is standing in for all kinds of things about America.
Right.
And in the case of Detroit, the reason that the tax base becomes so small is because of a loss of population, right? So folks move out, they're not there to pay the taxes on the homes, and the kind of deterioration is what you see in the numbers you suggest. But this lack of tax base is also exactly the thing that many Republicans would impose on us, even when our cities have sufficient populations, even when our communities have sufficient populations. This is what it looks like when government is small enough to drown in your bathtub. And it is not a pretty picture.
So if the government doesn't have enough people to steal money from, then you have Detroit. What do you think of that, Larken?
Oh, man. If I can stop laughing long enough to talk. I can't believe anybody would actually say that. Well, it's funny because it's like the thing where, you know, anybody can say, if not for this, there would be mayhem and death and destruction. You know, it's the stupid joke of somebody wearing some outlandish hat and somebody saying, why are you wearing that? It keeps the tigers away. There aren't any tigers around here. We'll see how well it works.
Yeah.
And so anybody can come along and say, if not for government, things would be worse. And if, you know, people can just choose to idiotically believe that if they want. But if you bring it down to a specific personal level, it's pretty easy to show how silly that is. Like if you ask somebody, okay, in your own life, do you think your finances would be improved by you being allowed to spend or save or invest your own money or by allowing politicians to take all of your money and spend it for you? Which do you think would be better for you? And nobody says the politician's taking it all. And yet, if the scale gets big, they've been duped into thinking, oh my gosh, we can't have people spend their own money and decide what they want to support and what they want to buy and run their own life, because that would be chaos and mayhem. No, we need this giant gang of parasites that bosses us around, steals our money, and makes civilization possible. And it's just, it's so weird that anybody believes that. But if you don't have anything to compare it to, it's easier to believe an insane lie. It's like, you know, in the Soviet Union, they could probably get away. They could probably have gotten away with the lie of if government wasn't here, you'd all starve. But that lie doesn't work here because we've seen food production that isn't controlled. You know, the government has its tentacles in it, but there isn't government guaranteed food for everyone. The day there is, people will be starving in the streets. But as long as people don't have freedom to compare it to, you can make these outlandish claims like this collapsing authoritarian monstrosity of Detroit that the problem is a lack of government power and revenue.
She's basically saying wet sidewalks cause rain. And I love that she quoted or incited or invoked Grover Norquist with his quote, yeah. I just want to shrink government down to the size where we can drown it in the bathtub. And he is a conservative libertarian minarchist that actually had the unenviable task of trying to get the Tea Party to sign pieces of paper saying they'd actually act like the Tea Party. And they all signed it and then immediately violated it. And, you know, a lot of conservatives look at him as an example, saying like, yes, we need to be more like him and less like Romney, you know, or less like Nancy Pelosi. But to me, you know, I like Grover Norquist, but to me, the gap between Nancy Pelosi and Grover Norquist is the same size as the gap between Grover Norquist and us. But not really, because they say that the hardest thing is that last mile, that last 10%, that last 1%. Yep. You know, it's pretty easy to use logic to get someone to go from uber statist to minarchist. But it's, as you've said, Larken, it's really hard to get someone to go from minarchist to a no government guy, let's call them an anarchist, you know, a peaceful anarchist. So why do you think that is? Why is that gap so difficult?
Because the last thing is a paradigm step and everything else is just sort of bickering about details. I mean, if you ask people, would you rather have a king who lets you keep 50% of what you earn or a king who lets you keep 60% of what you earn? You know, there's no existentially disturbing dilemma. People say, oh, I'd rather him let me keep 60% of what I earn. All political action is begging the masters to give us permission to be a little bit more free or to keep a little bit more of our money or whatever we're begging for. But that last step is the realization that we don't actually need their permission. And that's something that takes a major paradigm shift for people to say, stop begging the masters and just disobey them.
Yep. And we'll be back with more Freedom Feens.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Neema V and Michael Dean, Inoculation from Indoctrination. Learn more at freedomfiends.com. Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. Basic Handgun and Rifle with Jared Waltz.
First rule of being alive is you own yourself. A groundbreaking approach to firearms and self-defense training. Beautifully filmed and easy to understand instructions make this one a must-have. Gun Training with the Non-Aggression Principle, Volume 1. New DVD from Michael W. Dean. Available on Amazon. Your house is your property.
Yep, it's Freedom Feens. We're back. I'm Neema Vedadi. We've also got Michael W. Dean being our hype man today. Say what's up, Michael.
Yeah, and we have good news. During the break, we decided to press Larken Rose into libertarian indentured servitude as a soldier for the full show. So it was only going to be 1 hour, but we have drafted him, and he's written a letter to his wife that says, "My dearest Tessa, I believe that the war will not end, and I cannot leave my couch, and I am out of corn chips." Yeah,
he seems like a potato man to me.
What's that, Larken?
I think I'll live.
Yeah. So, Neema,
it's
set
that
him up.
Kind of bravery that, that compelled us to have him on the show. Today.
Set him up and let him knock it down.
Yeah. Okay. So, Larken, it's been said that if you get people asking the wrong questions, you don't have to worry about the answers. And you're right that the political discourse is how much should the government take from us and what laws should the government force us at gunpoint to follow instead of should we have this top-down ruling elite deciding our fate at all? How do you think you get people to understand that there is an alternative to tyrant A versus tyrant B? Do you have strategies? I mean, obviously, there's a bunch of people out now trying to do that. What are your thoughts on some of the strategies that could work?
Right. Well, the main thing is to go right for the paradigm and stop, you know, tinkering around the edges of a fundamentally bad idea known as statism. And it's pretty easy to demonstrate that most people have never even – it's never occurred to them what they're actually doing. Like when you petition for, you know, against some tax increase or you want some tax cut over here on this thing and you write to your congressman or you vote or you whine, and I'll ask somebody like that, okay, so aren't you sort of implying that how much of what you earn you'll be allowed to keep? That's not your choice. That's the government's choice. And all you're doing is saying, please, master, will you give me your permission for me to keep a little bit more of what I produce? And people don't like to look at it that way, even though that's totally what it is. Instead, they prefer the rhetoric of, no, they represent us and they serve us. They represent and serve us by bossing us around and taking our money and hurting us if we disobey. Mm-hmm. So the first thing is to get them to see the reality. In fact, almost the only thing is to get them to see reality. You really are asking a political master to let you keep more of your money. Now, what if instead of perpetually begging the parasitic, narcissistic sociopaths in Washington to give us their holy permission to be a little tiny bit freer, what if by some miracle tomorrow the whole country suddenly had the mentality, it's our choice whether to give you our money or not. We don't need you giving us a tax cut. We don't need you repealing a tax. We will repeal it by not giving you money. But that really is shifting from the mentality of a slave to the mentality of a free human being. Shifting from the idea that we really want the permission of authority to be allowed to keep our money or run our own life or be armed or, you know, whatever the issue is, and shifting over to, we don't need your permission. You might attack us and we'll have to deal with that. But like, nobody sends a heartfelt letter to the carjacker saying, will you please tell me I'm allowed to keep my car? But
well, I really love how you put the emphasis on if tomorrow the mindset had changed. That's the most important part. It's not that if tomorrow the state disappeared, because even if tomorrow the state disappeared, there'd still be the mindset. So in that context, Adam Kokesh has said, you know, in that piece we played, that in 2020 he wants to run for president on the platform that he is going to in an orderly fashion dissolve the federal government. What do you think about that? Given that the point is to change the mindset, not be some master and just take the government apart from the top, right?
Yeah, the thing is, from everything I've heard from Adam, he understands that. You know, he knows that what's in people's minds is the thing that matters. When people stop hallucinating an obligation to bow to the crooks in D.C., we're done. Like so many people assume that, you know, if I say I'm anti-government, I want to do something to the government. No, I want people to understand they ought to just ignore it and stop pretending it's their master.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's Larken Rose, LarkenRose.com. Here on the Freedom Feens, FREEDOM Feens, Foxtrot Echo Echo November Sierra.com. We'll have more in hour two from Larken Rose with myself, Michael Dean, and Neema Vedadi on the Freedom Feens, and maybe a question from Neema's mother who's in the chat room. I love to say that. I love to say that.
I know you do. Making me blush.
All yeah. Right.
Feens.
Need to talk to people in a secure manner? Liberty Private Network sells phones that will work over any good internet connection and give you military-grade encryption for calls that cannot be tapped. Great for lawyers and clients, business people with trade secrets, or just ordinary folk who don't want their love talk spied on by some scumbag from the central scrutinizer. Call 516-TLK-SAFE on your non-secure phone and tell them the Freedom Feens sent you. That's 516-TLK-SAFE.
Howdy, I'm Ben Stone from the Bad Quaker Podcast. I'll teach you the difference between the government and the state, why the government is nothing without the state, and how to dissolve the state while remaining peaceful and even calm. I knew the state was a losing proposition decades before that was cool. Check out the Bad Quaker Podcast at badquaker.com. We have a forum and it's got gardening tips. That's badquaker.com.
Yeah, it's the Freedom Feens. You know you love it. That's why you came back for hour two.
I love it.
You yep. Love it? Yeah.
And,
you're
this,
fiending.
This is the Freedom Feens, and we have a voluntary guest on today talking about voluntarism, and his name is Larken Rose, LarkenRose.com. And he was going to do an hour, but we've initiated the libertarian stop loss program. So we are not letting the voluntary soldier of the mind go back home. We're going to keep him for another hour. And we have a question from Neema's mother, and I've pigeoned it. I've sent it in encrypted text to Neema so yes. He can bug his own house and read it publicly. Go ahead and Neema's mom has a question here for Larken Rose.
I do love my mom so much, but apparently I'm such a bad son that she has to talk to me through the chat room on a radio show. I promise to call you tomorrow, pinky swear, mama. But she asks in the chat room, she says, as a mom with sons who are anarchists, yes, I've convinced my brothers. So she says, as a mom with sons who are anarchists, I sometimes worry about their safety. Does his mom worry about him? She says in reference to Larken. Does your mom worry about you, Larken?
Well, now she may be up in heaven worrying about me. Both of my parents passed away in the last few years. I will answer about the, you know, in the recent past, because I've been an anarchist for 16, almost 17 years now. In short, yes, but she also totally understood why I don't really think I have a choice in the matter. You know, if the choices are put myself at risk by trying to do whatever I can to drag the world in the direction of morality and justice, if that's one choice and the other choice is to quietly sit here while the world crashes into a totalitarian disaster, I'm less worried about the former. And I've also discovered myself that I can't not do this. Like, I can't even make me shut up. You know, if somebody shoots me, that'll make me shut up. Short of that, then forget it. And so, yeah, my parents were very understanding. I will quick relate this thing that I wasn't there to see it. I got it secondhand. They both understood, and I was nudging them. And they were around 80 each when they passed away. My dad passed away about a year before my mom. And the funniest thing I ever heard was my mom describing to me how there was some caller, because they used to be big Republicans, and some caller asking for donations or something. And my dad answered the phone and like, well, don't you support whatever the candidate is? Well, no, not really. Well, aren't you with this? And and, well, what are you politically? And my dad said, I'm an anarchist. And there was dead silence, and then the guy hung up. So I was so thrilled to hear that he identified himself as an anarchist. Aww. So, yeah, but to get to the question, yeah, it's a serious question because there are real threats because people in power like to hang on to power and they like to do nasty things. I think actually when somebody gets enough well-known, you know, I'm not exactly world famous, but you get to a point where enough people are paying attention that it seeks to be worth it for the control freaks to just knock somebody off. It just looks a little too suspicious. Mm-hmm. So I think there's actually more to be worried about if somebody is a little tiny bit vocal about it.
I think our canary in a coal mine is Alex Jones. As long as he's as long as he's doing radio that day, I'm like, all right, I'm probably safe.
Right. Until a drone beans him, I'm pretty sure I'm below him on the list. So,
yeah. Well, that whole concept used to make me feel really safe too, but I feel like there's a new thing now with Adam Kokesh being swatted basically for talking about the same kind of stuff we do. I mean, obviously we don't go into the, you know, cocking shotguns in DC on camera saying it'll be the second American Revolution. That's just not our style. But the concept that the federal government should be dissolved, that would be a good thing. We're totally on board with that. So do you see this this Kokesh thing as bringing something new to worry about?
Well, he totally intentionally handed them a legal excuse to attack him and act like fascists, knowing that they would, and probably in a way wanting them to, because the whole point of civil disobedience is I'm going to be here and not hurt anybody, and then they're going to come be fascists, and I hope people see that and say, wow, that's not really okay. So he gave them a legal excuse. So far, I don't see people having their doors kicked in by, and the charge is you're saying things we don't want you to say.
The thing that's blowing me away about the whole Adam thing is all of the Second Amendment bayonet polishers who say, well, there's a line in the sand, and when it's crossed, it's too far, you know, and who don't like Adam. Adam's thing was kind of like the Boston Tea Party. He didn't hurt anybody. He didn't even go as far as the original Boston Tea Party and destroy property. He just stood there and said, yeah.
Oh, you're right.
Yep.
I think we lost Michael.
If I'm going to die, I want it to be doing something I love, which is eating Chinese food and doing radio. So, yeah.
Speaking of them knocking people off, did anybody slip some poison in there while we were
in the middle of
this discussion?
I'm okay. But now the government knows I order Chinese food, and there's only one place in town that does takeout, so they can poison me pretty easily.
They'll be poisoned. Yeah. But just I think the – you know, we're sort of joking around about it, but I know a lot of people who are literally really scared to say what they think, even in private, in the land of the free. And to me, that's just the biggest indication there can possibly be that we better get loud and we better do it right now, because it's, you know, name one country that ever got to the point where the people didn't dare to speak their minds that didn't end up at complete totalitarianism. And so when people, you know, when Adam does things like this to intentionally, bait them into acting like the fascists they are and doing a raid and all that, hopefully some people are seeing it saying this is ridiculous. I think some of the sort of part-time Second Amendment people who criticize them, some of it's just sort of criticizing the tactics, like, oh, you look too extreme being anti-government and stuff, because a lot of them
Or there's something behind it of like, you're young and sexy and I'm old and middle-aged. I'm envious. Some like crab mentality right there, maybe.
There could be a whole bunch of like psychological things in there. But I think actually a big part of it is even the people who say, yeah, they won't cross this line or I'm going to stand up. I think a lot of people who say that aren't even really sure inside their own heads, because if somebody really believes in authority and takes pride in being a law-abiding taxpayer, in other words, they take pride in obeying politicians and handing over money to them, there is a big psychological hurdle. And I won't explain the whole thing, but one of the best things people can read about this is the experiments done by Stanley Milgram, which can be found in his book, Obedience to Authority. The truth of the matter is most Americans do not have the spine to do what they know is right if a perceived authority is telling them to do something else. And I think that's probably true of a lot of people who claim to be Second Amendment supporters. So it makes them uncomfortable to even hear somebody say, you know, they can be perfectly comfortable with people saying, let's petition our congressman and whine for this or that legislation, because that's within the game you're allowed to think about. But to hear people say, let's disobey, is completely outside of that paradigm. It's into the paradigm of they are no longer our rightful lords and masters, and we don't have an obligation to do what they say. And I think the problem is literally most people don't even dare to think about that. And it comes out in the way they talk and the way they act. So they freak out when somebody, you know, suggests, how about instead of asking for permission, you just act like a free human being and don't think it's the politician's business to tell you whether you're allowed to or not.
A really good example, I think, is I would say that most people I've met who own scary black rifles or so-called assault rifles, you know, military pattern, semi-auto, you know, removable magazine, you know, weapons of war. They are, well, they can be used as weapons of war. The Boston Tea Party said that the writer, not the event, Boston Tea Party said that no revolutions are won with pistols or shotguns. And they won't ever really take away your pistols and shotguns. They'll take away your battle rifles and your assault type rifles because that's what they're most afraid of. And most people who own those type of weapons are very strong believers in the Second Amendment and say, we have the right to have these. But recently, Connecticut required registration of all those types of guns, and people have started registering them. And David Kadria, who we had on here recently, had a two-word assessment of that that was brilliant. He said, Mulan labia. And I'm not going to go into the Greek or the etymology, but, you know, most people listening,
the mangling of the Greek.
You know, he's basically calling them kitty cats, let's say, for doing that.
Your butchering of the pronunciation was priceless.
Yeah. But it wasn't labe. You're getting that, right?
He meant to do that on purpose. Yeah.
Yes.
That's well, if positive. I said, did I say
intentional
Mulan
butcher,
wrong? Yeah. How do you say Mulan? It's not Moulin Rouge. I know that. But anyway,
close it off.
You get the joke. You get the joke and you get what he's saying. He's saying all these people who say they'll take my guns from my cold, dead hands. You know, a lot of those people are saying, well, they'll all take them from my cold, dead hands, but I'm taking them down to register them at the local sheriff's office.
Right.
Moulin labia. Yeah. Yeah.
And I did a short video because I have one of those things. I won't give my blunt answer why people ask, why does anybody need one of them? Second Amendment explains why anybody needs one of them. But I did the video to distinguish between, like, okay, how many people are going to whine for politicians to please let you keep your AR-15 or whatever you have, and how many people are not going to give it up no matter what the control freaks declare to be legislation, because that's really all that matters. Is if people, you know, if people say we believe in this and we demand this and that and the other thing, but in the end we'll obey anything that the parasites call law, then you're just a slave. It's like, we believe in the Second Amendment as long as government tells us we're allowed to be armed. Like, oh, that works wonderfully. It's like, I will defend myself against the carjacker unless the carjacker tells me I'm not allowed to.
Yeah, because the origin of the Second Amendment is basically that a big reason for the Revolutionary War was they took the local, powder keg repository. They basically took the guns away and they were taxing them a tiny fraction of what taxes are overall today. And, basically they went out and fought a war over it and then put in writing on some paper, if anyone ever tries to take these again, you have them. And the unwritten part of that is to use them. And I'm not saying go shoot people, but I'm saying anybody who owns a gun and thinks they believe in the Second Amendment and turns it in when told to probably doesn't really understand the Second Amendment. We'll have more on that with Larken Rose when we come back from the market on the Freedom Feens.
Thank you. This is Michael Dean from the Freedom Feens. I've been on the World Wide Web since its inception in 1994. I've tried dozens of web providers in that time. The only one that hasn't broken my heart is HostGator. HostGator has unlimited server space, unlimited throughput, and a guaranteed uptime of better than 99.9% for only $150 a year. You can pay a little less elsewhere, but you'll pull out your hair dealing with anyone else. HostGator has great service and unlimited tech support only a phone call away 24/7, 365. HostGator is where pros like the Feens host, because we know how to do it right. Go to freedomfiends.com and click on the HostGator affiliate link on the right sidebar to sign up today.
Holla, holla. Yes.
Holla.
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 Holla, 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 holla. It's the Freedom Feens. We are back. Yeah. I'm Neema V. We've also got Michael Dean.
I'm Michael
and somebody
Dean.
Whose name doesn't rhyme. What's your problem, Larken? Larken Rose. Come on.
Sorry,
all right. We do have Mr. Rose here, not in the house, but in our ear. How's it going, Larken?
Pretty good.
We were conjecturing on the break about, since I said I like to eat Chinese food and I choked on a little bit of it, that right now there's maybe somebody at some government agency looking through the computer Rolodex to see if they have an agent who is Chinese American and has experience working in a Chinese restaurant and experience with poisons, so they can park him in Casper, Wyoming and do away with me. I don't think we're that important yet. I really don't. I think they will just mess with us and, you know, audit us or something at this point.
I love to look at the game from the, it's like looking at the chessboard from the other guy's side, to look at it from the tyrant's side. And as much as they huff and puff and try to look big and bad, they have to just be terrified, because, and not like terrified of getting blown up, but just terrified of their power is falling apart, precisely because there's a lot of people who just don't see them as rightful lords and masters anymore.
Well,
and you can't force that on somebody.
We decided also, we have a Chinese restaurant motif here, I actually have a fortune cookie on my corkboard here where I have the show clock and the list of words you can't say on radio and my pinup boy picture of Edward R. Murrow. I have a fortune cookie fortune that says, you will always live in interesting times, which is a pretty bizarre fortune cookie fortune, because that is a Chinese curse. May you always live in interesting times. And you don't usually get a curse in a fortune cookie fortune, like, you will die soon. That's basically what that's saying. And I have it up on my corkboard for inspiration. I think we're going to call this episode Larken Rose, May You Always Live in Interesting Times. And I think we are living in very interesting times, because America's getting a little more tyrannical than it's been overall before. And I say a little more tyrannical, but it's really not. Like, first of all, doing this radio show during World War I would have gotten us deported or charged for sedition. And the same thing with even like the pundits. I mean, like, they would have thrown Glenn Beck in prison then probably not, because he towed the line. But during World War II, no station would have taken us, but they also would have probably thrown us in prison for something. You know, they've thrown Japanese Americans in prison for being Japanese Americans. They've done all sorts of horrible things. I think there's more free speech now than there's ever been. Everyone doing it is more looking over their shoulder now than ever, but there's more of it than ever. And I think we live in interesting times, because anarchy is becoming hip. I mean, really, it's hip. It's cool. And like, they wouldn't have let Adam Kokesh on TV to say what he's saying even 3 or 4 years ago. They wouldn't have they wouldn't have done that news piece. And there's so many people, like, being libertarian has become hip in the time I've been a libertarian, which is like 5 or 6 years. I mean, like, it was not hip then. And now, like, all the cool kids are doing it. And it's getting to the point where there's a lot of people going, well, that's not far enough. Maybe we need no government. And like, that's kind of becoming hip now too. So we live in interesting times. And you know, they say Grover Norquist said he'd like government to be so small he could drown it in the bathtub. The Feens say we would like to remove the demand for government to the point where it drowns itself in the bathtub and says, nobody loves me. And I think we're headed. That's what they're afraid of. That's what they're a lot more afraid of than people having guns, you know?
Yeah. And the mental issue, the battle of philosophy and ideas, is the only one that matters. Because if if a few people understand concepts of self-ownership and the non-aggression principle, Then the control freaks will probably send out some mindless mercenaries to attack them or drone them or whatever. But as it spreads, you know, literally picture what happens if everybody in the country except the politicians realizes you're not really helping us and you don't really have the right to rule us and we don't owe you allegiance or any money. So, meh. Like, what happens?
Or even a large minority.
Right. But if it's everybody, I would start with the everybody and say, you know, if Congress says smite them, they look around, there's nobody to do any smiting. Because even their enforcers are lied to.
That's why they're working on RoboCops.
Right. But it's funny because now they're condemning their own soldiers as potential terrorists. You know, veterans are, we're worried about them, and you know, their own mercenaries. And I know they have to be scared of their military, because there's a lot of people in the military that remember that they swore an oath to uphold the Constitution. And they know who is the biggest threat to the Constitution.
Think about the fact that the Department of Homeland Security has labeled Oath Keepers as potential terrorists. And the Oath Keepers are people who remind cops and soldiers to honor the constitutional oath they took. That is literally considered, you got to watch that guy now. Interesting times on the Freedom Feens, and we'll be back after this trip to the market with Larken Rose.
Want to contribute to Liberty but short on cash? You can help the Freedom Feens without even spending a post-1964 dime. Download uTorrent and start seeding Feens episodes and DVDs to help keep us drone-proof. There's a Torrent Club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. There you'll find our Torrent RSS feed and instructions to grab past episodes and automatically download new ones, even while you're away from the computer. You'll also get special episodes of The Feens and Anarchy Gumbo days or even weeks before regular podcast subscribers who aren't torrenting. Leave your computer on, seeding the torrents while you're at work or asleep. The more people seeding The Feens, the more drone-proof we'll be when the boot comes down.
All right. We're back on Freedom Feens Live. It is Saturday, July 20th, 2/13, and we've got Larken Rose with us. And
that's LarkenRose.com, LarkenRose.com. And, you know, a lot of people say things like, Obama's like Hitler. And then people say, you can't say that. And here's the thing. Obama's not like Hitler. But someone recently pointed out how if the next guy is like Hitler, Bush and Obama and a few other folks have really set up something that a tyrant would drool over. Someone called it a turnkey tyranny, which basically, you know, turnkey, you buy a turnkey business. It means you could just walk in and start the business. Like, it's got all the equipment, the building, all the licensing, all the things you need to start to run the business. It's a turnkey business. Now, Bush and Obama in particular have set up a turnkey tyranny to where if the next guy who comes in thinks like Hitler, he's got indefinite detention. He's got everybody wiretapped. He's got a totally militarized police force in every town who have tanks and weapons of war, et cetera, et cetera. He's got laws that you can arrest anybody for, you know, anytime you want. He's got a jury system set up that you can convict anyone, whether they did it or not.
Well, it sounds like we're already at tyranny if we have all those things.
Yeah,
though,
but we're
it?
Still running around That's like, lovely. You know, free, open range, free range tax slaves. Larken did a video that cannot be named. We call it the video that cannot be named on radio, even though there's no cussing in the video or the title. We just can't say it. We can't say it. But it is basically about the when should people resist tyranny to save themselves from the gulags and being shot in the back of the head and thrown into a mass grave. So talk a little about that, Larken.
The point of the video that cannot be named and the point of having a title that cannot be named was to make people freak out and watch it. And just to start people thinking in a direction that the mainstream media will never have them thinking in. And the political system and the pundits and them.
Well, didn't Glenn Beck call you a terrorist?
Or something like that? Not quite, but somebody printed out a flyer of the article and he was saying, this is the dangerous stuff that's out there. And course, he didn't tell people how to find it or actually read the article.
Yeah, and someone was handing it out at an Occupy Wall Street thing to try to educate the Occupy Wall Street people. And he thought it came from Occupy Wall Street, right? And said that that's why they're
bad.
Yeah,
so he was blaming them. And I still don't even know who did it. Not that I care. It was down in Phoenix, actually. It was Occupy Phoenix thing. But the point of the article, and later it was made into a video, which can be found on my YouTube channel, is just to ask people the uncomfortable questions. See, people are perfectly comfortable with the utterly pointless debate of what would you like to ask your masters to allow you to do? And like, oh, wow, I would like to ask them to let me keep more of my money and let me be armed and let me run my own business and let me maybe have a lemonade stand with my kids and radical things like that. And that whole debate, you know, if you look in history at all the tyrannies, there were lots of people trying to vote against them and petition against them and speak out against them. But when it came right down to it, what did that accomplish? Nothing.
Well, like, wasn't Hitler democratically elected and like legally elected? And, you know, everything he did was by the law because he kept changing the law.
Yeah, it was actually slightly indirect. He wasn't directly elected, but the Nazis were elected into power, and then they appointed him as. And yeah, it was all legal. And for people who don't know, look it up in the constitutions of the Soviet Union and Red China and North Korea.
Yes,
they all have the right to vote. They have the right to vote.
They have the right to free speech in some of those countries in their documents.
Yeah, they have their equivalent of their Bill of Rights, and it sounds a lot like ours, and fat lot of good it did for them. But the thing is, so this video that cannot be named, the whole point is basically to ask people. It's not even telling them much of anything. It's ask people, at what point will you actually disobey? Is there a point? Or if you were in Nazi Germany, would you just cry and beg and vote and then go, oh, well, we lost, you know, that's the way the political process works, so I guess we'll get on the cattle cars. Or at some point you say, I don't care what the law is, I don't care what authority says, I don't care what government says, this is what is right, and here's where I draw the line. And I don't, you know, in the video that cannot be named, I don't insist that everybody draw their line where mine is. I don't even really say where my line is, and it's different lines for different issues. But basically asking people, is there any line at which you disobey, or are you such a slave that literally your government can do absolutely anything to you and all you'll ever do is whine about it and then go along with it and obey and bow and grovel and kiss the ring? Because if there's anything that makes this country different, it's that there was once upon a time that spirit of, you know, as expressed in the Declaration of Independence, hey, when we decide that you're a violator of individual rights instead of a protector, we don't have to vote you out. We don't have to petition you. We don't have to beg you. We have the right and the duty to do whatever it takes to stop you from violating individual rights. And most Americans are literally terrified of talking about that, of thinking about it, you know, much less actually doing it. You know, just the question of at what point would you resist aggression that's done in the name of law? Lots of people just get all emotional and freak out. You should never, you vote or take them to court or petition or whine or something, but then do as you're told. And unfortunately, history shows pretty darn clearly that any people that has that mindset, that will not resist but will beg and petition and vote, they will always end up at complete tyranny. I mean, there's a great Frederick Douglass quote, which if I planned ahead, I'd have in front of me. It's something like the find out the exact amount of injustice that people will tolerate, and you have found out the exact amount which will be imposed upon them until they resist with words or blows or both. And that the limits of tyrants are prescribed by the endurance of those they oppress, meaning they will do anything to you unless you resist. And voting isn't resisting, and saying stuff isn't resisting. Disobedience is resisting. So it's really, you know, the video that can't be named. The question is really, is there any point at which you will disobey? Because if not, you're just a slave. Please step out of the way and let the real adults try to save you from the totalitarianism that you don't have the spine to resist.
Well, you tried that in court, and the people you were trying to save sent you to federal prison for a year. So do you have hope for the future?
Well, my only hope is having enough people figure things out. I mean, my court thing was playing within the system and hoping that somebody on the jury wouldn't be an idiot. No such luck. But even that is sort of playing inside the game. The only hope this country or any country has of being free is if there are enough people, and it doesn't have to be a majority, but there are enough people who say, yeah, we're just going to disobey if you do that. Whatever it is, whatever, wherever they want to draw the line, only a people that at least has a line somewhere has any chance of being free, because the tyrants don't ever, ever stop because you ask them nicely. The only time they ever stop is when you say, bad things are going to happen if you step over this line, so don't. Because that's
well,
all they care
about. I don't think it's any accident that the majority of people feel that way, that they just bow before authority. That's what they're taught, and that's what they're drilled into their heads, not only in school, but when they get out of school and they watch mass media. They're also drilled in the head with the concept that the state is your loving protector and the only hope of saving the world from any kind of evil, nasty zombies or whatever it is. These are the themes in fiction and in education. How do we as people who I guess get it fight against this massive propaganda machine that has more resources than we probably could ever hope to acquire?
Yeah, well, that's, you know, that question is sort of what I try to do every day in every way I can possibly think of. And I've been thrilled, just to be self-serving for a second here, by how many people have told me that my book, The Most Dangerous Superstition, totally turned their paradigm inside out, and they changed from being a slave asking for permission to somebody who understands that they own themselves. And that doesn't mean, haha, I'm going to go disobey and then they can run me over with a tank. Like, self-preservation isn't a sin. And what matters is how many people actually know what freedom is and want it. If one person wants it, he's doomed. He's in a cage or he's dead. If a million want it, then something actually happens. Because then it becomes the mentality that we shouldn't bow. We should act like free human beings. And that's the only time it works.
Bringing it back full circle here. So I would say Adam Kokesh did exactly what you're talking about in his video. He said, I won't obey. Do you think there's anything to be said for choosing your battles? And do you think he chose a self-destructive battle with that video?
Well, it sort of remains to be seen. I mean, with his, and I said the same thing when he was talking about the march on Washington and the armed march, not for let's go shoot them, but just to have a demonstration that we don't care what you say and we have the right to be armed. You know, I can wait till it's over and then in retrospect tell you whether it was tactically a good idea, which is a little bit cowardly.
That's how history's written. People say, exactly. I was with the winner from the beginning. And right. I was vocally against that march. I thought it was a horrible idea. I thought it was a suicide march. I really like his video. I'm sad that he's in prison and they're trying to charge him with really scary crimes that make the thing you went to prison for look like literally a country club, which it kind of was by comparison.
Yeah. Isn't he out or was he just about to get out?
I think he's out on bond. But it's something like he can't be around people who have guns. And since he can't go home because his roommates have guns, the judge said you can go stay in a local homeless shelter, which seems like shaming to me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think he's out temporarily, but you know, they're trying to charge him with, you know, federal gun charges. And DC is a weird no man's land that's even different and harder core than federal. And the state of Virginia is trying to charge him with mushrooms, which he says weren't his, and which is a class A drug felony. And the feds are talking about charging him with sedition, which is like, you know, they put you in the catapult and launch you into the next county and kill you or something or hang you. I don't know what they do. It's an old law. I don't know what the punishment is.
See, there are a lot of things like this that tell me that the American control freaks are getting really desperate and really stupid. Because, I mean, when you try to characterize millions of people as potential terrorists, you know, What, you think you're going to convince them? If you mention the Constitution, you might be a terrorist. Oh, well, then never mind. I don't like freedom anymore.
It's we'll just, be back on Freedom Feens with Larken Rose after this.
You're listening to Freedom Feens with Neema V and Michael Dean. That proves you're smarter than most people.
Love the Feens and want to help out? We do take donations and we put them back into our Liberty projects. You can make a donation by clicking on the spinning coin on any post. But what if you want to help but you ain't got no cash? Or you made a donation and you want to help more? Here's how you can help. Download and seed our torrents to help keep us drone-proof. There's a torrent club link at the top of freedomfiends.com. You can also blog the Feens and share episode links on Facebook, Twitter, and elsewhere. You can rate and review our movies on Amazon and IMDb. You can rate and review the Freedom Feens and our songs on iTunes. That really helps a lot. You can buy our movies and share them with friends or give them out as gifts. And one of the best ways to spread liberty is to buy a bunch of Freedom Feens buttons and give them out as gifts. Wholesale prices are available, and you can also comment on our site, or better yet, comment about us on other sites. And please email the site link to all your friends. Thanks for helping spread the Feens message worldwide to as many liberty people as you can, especially to those who don't yet get it. You rock.
Welcome back, Feens, and what a show for me to be welcoming you back to. I am Neema Vedadi. We've also got Michael W. Dean and our special third chair here today, Larken Rose. How's everybody doing?
I'm good. I thought of something over the break. I was thinking that since free speech is such a variable line these days of what you can say and can't say, which is really the sign of they are terrified of free speech, I think that we should come up with a product that we sell or give away for radio hosts that's like the government threat meter, like Stan Smith has on his refrigerator in American Dad, that is the level of threat the government has against the people that day. So you can moderate your words on radio of, oh, yes. Let's say, okay, the government threat level today against us is orange. So the video will not be named, but we'll talk about it. So go ahead, Larken, tie it up in a pretty bow and send us home.
Well, here's the thing I often end with. You know, it's we've in this country for a couple hundred years, we've had the game of politics and we've had the game of elections and people speaking out and voting and petitioning and doing that. And whether you're Democrat or Republican or whatever else, it's pretty clear that we've been going downhill pretty much for 200 years in a row. And the thing is, it's so easy and it's so tempting for everybody, including me, to want to look out at the world and say, that guy, it's his fault, and that guy over there, it's his fault, and those people, they believe the wrong thing, and to always say, everything wrong with the world is somebody else's fault. If we just had the government I wanted, if I was in charge, everything would be great, but all these stupid people are ruining it. And that's a lot more fun, although completely useless, is a lot more fun than backing up and saying, well, what do I actually believe in, and what am I condoning, and what am I actually achieving? And so what I would suggest to people, which is really uncomfortable, is question your own assumptions and your own belief system. Because in the end, the only thing that actually matters is what is between your ears and between the ears of 300 million other Americans, or between the ears of 7 billion human beings on the planet. Because so much of the problem is not in Washington. And when I say that, I don't mean there aren't corrupt, lying, crooked psychos in Washington. There are plenty of them. But all of their power comes from us. And I don't just mean in paying taxes. I mean in the rest of us imagining that it's legitimate, imagining that we should go along with it, imagining an obligation to obey. And if you look at all the, you know, use the example of nasty tyrants in history, you know, Hitler and Stalin and Mao. The only reason we know their names is not because of them on their own. It's because each of them had millions of people who perceived those individual tyrants as authority. Adolf Hitler did not by himself kill millions of people. He had law-abiding taxpayers fund the monster that did it for him. He had law enforcers obeying orders and doing as they're told, doing it for him. And here's the most uncomfortable part. Most of them were good people. The problem was not that they were all malicious and evil and nasty. The problem was they believed so thoroughly in authority that when a perceived authority told them to go do evil stuff, they literally thought, well, it's the law. I have no choice. I got to do what I'm told. You know, I might vote. I might petition. I might object. But in the end, you got to do as you're told. And I'm telling you, the world will never improve. Nothing will prevent tyranny except people coming to the realization you have to not do as you are told when your own moral code and your own judgment tells you that what you are told is wrong. We don't need millions of Americans saying, we don't like this war, please stop. We need millions of Americans saying, we don't like this war and we're not paying for it anymore. We're not asking, we're just not giving you our money anymore. Or we don't like the war on drugs because it's evil and violent and we're not going to tolerate it, we're not going to cooperate. But that is a fundamental shift in attitude. And if people can't make that shift, all their good intentions, all their virtues are worthless. Until you can stand up and say, this is what I believe in, and I don't care how important the guy is telling me I have to obey, I'm going to do what I know is right and ignore what is legal and what is government and what is authority.
That was beautiful, Larken Rose, at larkenrose.com. And this has been the Freedom Feens. Thanks, man. It's been an honor having you here.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Freedom Feens with Neema V and Michael Dean. Make an appointment to listen while it's still legal. Learn more about the Feens and download archived shows at freedomfeens.com. That's F-R-E-E-D-O-M-F-E-E-N-S.com.